not the surgical management. Surgical management is quite a difficult topic, very, very detailed. I don't think for today's discussion it's of value. So I'm going to speak about the impact of global pain in society, the rationale for treatment, and new ways of thinking. So it's the most expensive benign condition in medicine, most common disabling illness for patients below the age of 45. In Australia in 2004, they found that they spent more than $1 billion in direct hospital costs. In Sweden, the rise in lost work days in Sweden alone was 40-fold over the last 30 years. So it's on the increase, and it's costing a lot on the economy of these big nations. Another study from England, and that's the curve. Started from 78 when they started looking into back pain, and this is the increment. 160 times, or let's say 8 times more than over the last 20 years. 80% of the population have at least one significant episode of low back pain, and I'm sure GPs in the community will tell you about that. 80% of them, they recover over 6 weeks. And only 7 to 10% of them develop chronic low back pain. The chronic low back pain occurs in 70 to 80% of course of low back pain. So despite the fact that the chronic back pain is only 10% of these population, they are the headache. Chronic chronicity is the headache. Return to work, 50% at 6 months, 30% at 1 year, and 5% at 2 years. And these are the figures for chronic low back pain. The problem with back pain is it doesn't follow the medical model. So this is, for example, the medical model. You have a disease. You have symptoms and signs. You take the history, you examine, you do the investigation, and you get to the diagnosis. In back pain, there is always an extra stuff. There is the functional overlay. There is the normal degenerative process versus the pathology, as mentioned. And you get the diagnosis from first encounter in 15% of cases. In the medical model, typical model, you have the treatment, and your patient is finished. While in back pain, you need to rest. You think of rest. You need to think of analgesia, and obviously surgery is something that you need to consider, provided that both has failed. In rest, again, you need to think of tissue deconditioning, pain from stretching, and analgesia, and the pain management team will speak more about it. You need to think about medications, dependence, and abuse. And again, the problem with surgery is that it has poor outcome. In the best case scenario, you're talking about 70% success rate of any surgical intervention for pure back pain. So regarding the back pain problem, there's the pathology, the impairment, the disability, the handicap, all that's all into the back pain problem. You need to think of biology, the psychological aspect of it, and obviously the social aspect. What they call, and that's where it differs from the typical scenario, they call it the biopsychosocial model applies for back pain. Assessment, as mentioned, you need to think of anatomy, you need to think of the details of the examination of the back, and causes. Congenital is something that you tend to forget. Again, traumatic, inflammatory, neoplastic, alcohol, non-spinal, all causes. But remember, the big issue regarding low back pain is degenerative. People come with facet joint problem. It's a very common problem that tends to be forgotten in the community, especially around the age of 40. And idiopathic, there is no harm to say to the patient, well, I don't know what's the problem with your back pain. Remember, it's the psychosocial issues as well. You need to spend a lot of time with the patient. Some of us have that luxury, others don't. In kids, it's quite a rare condition. We spoke about scoliosis. In athletics, we are talking about the traumatic part of things. And obviously, work-related and degenerative, and then degenerative for the elderly. Think about stenosis in addition to facet joint problems. As mentioned earlier, follow the pattern of look, feel, and move. You want methods. Be comprehensive as much as you could. When it comes to neurology examination, think about tension signs and the compression signs. Have a map in your mind regarding which nerve root goes to which dermatome. That always helps in identifying the problems. Sometimes the same pathology at the same level can cause different dermatomes. Remember, if it's close to the foramen or extra foramen. I'm not going to repeat that, but just certain things can give you a hint. If there is weakness in the tibialis anterior, there is loss of knee reflex, there is loss of sensations over the base of the big toe. This is you are talking about myotome. The same for S1. When you have a problem with plantar flexion, loss of ankle reflex, and paresthesia over the lateral side of the toe, this is S1. This is certain, in a busy clinic, if you have certain signs in your mind, you can get to know which level is involved. Please don't forget hip problems. Examine pulses. We spoke about neurogenic versus vascular. It's very important, especially when you're dealing with patients over 60 years of age. And abdomen. We tend to forget the abdomen. Sometimes aortic problems can cause leg problems. I'm gonna remind you with certain famous signs, weather signs we call it. These guys, they are non-organic symptoms. They keep coming back to our clinic, and we are puzzled. Why are they coming back? We don't have pathological problem, no organic problem. And it's the non-organic signs. They have superficial tenderness, non-anatomical, simulation upon axial loading. Normally they don't have to have, normally the patients don't get problem with axial loading. These guys get a problem with axial loading. Pain on rotation, again, this is non-organic. When you do the distraction test, when you do the leg straight leg raising test, as mentioned by Mujib, they are stiff. When you sit them down on the bench and raise the leg, they raise to 90 degrees. That's what they call distraction. And obviously they have regional, not dermatomal or myotomal, we have regional weakness and sensations. This is again non-organic. They are overreacting, even on touch. Please think about these signs and think of other psychosocial issues regarding back pain. In Europe, as you're aware, there is always claims and they get claims and compensation. This is a very big issue in Europe, not as much in the Middle East. I move on to management. There are certain occupations that predispose to back pain, associating simple low back, we need to differentiate between simple low back pain and sciatica. Sometimes the patient comes to our clinic and they say, doctor, I've been told I have sciatica. No, it's different from sciatica to simple low back pain. Avoid any activity that might trigger back pain. Again, this is a sort of conception. You know, I was told not to do things. As long as the spine is stable, patient is not supposed to be advised not to avoid doing things. That might actually aggravate things. So what I'm trying to say is there is no occupation that associated in the literature that increases back pain. We need to make it simple to the patient that he doesn't have sciatica, it's just simple back pain, and rest more than 2 days in acute back symptoms is not recommended anymore. The Canadians had this this thing about rest, and they we used to give weeks on weeks, and they recommended only 2 days for acute or back pain and get back to activities as much as you could. The United States Agency for Healthcare Policy Research Task, they defined the red flag, and our colleague Rajay kindly touched on that. It's very important. People in the community need to remember the red flag. I'm not going to go again through them, but I'm going to just flash the slides for you to remember. Please, people below the age of 20, above the age of 50, you don't just take them for granted as back pain. They need to be investigated. Being unwell, weight loss, widespread neurology, non-thoracic back pain, structural deformity as mentioned, and obviously history of infection and malignancy. Refer, these cases need to be known by people in the community. These are red flag symptoms. Remember, 70% of cancer deaths have bone metastases. 70% of bone metastases are spinal. And 70% of spinal mets needs referral. And 70% of these referrals need surgery. We don't want to bore you with MRIs. We know we love MRIs. Look at that. Tumors on both T1 and T2 eating the vertebra. Again, remember the cauda equina problem, sphincter disturbances, studied anesthesia, bilateral sciatica, gait disturbances. This is cauda equina. If there is anything in our practice that needs urgent intervention, it's cauda equina. The problem about it is that you encounter it once or twice in your lifetime, but it's quite disastrous for the patient if we don't catch it early and refer early. We spoke about Basel and the risk factors for chronicity. So these guys with chronic low back pain, so they have cumulative work absence, radiating leg symptoms, they have straight leg raising test positive, poor physical fitness, smoking, depression, low job satisfaction, that all contributes to the chronicity of the problem. And again, in a busy clinic, sometimes it's difficult to go through that. Maybe the luxury for GPs in the community to think about all these factors. Again, psychosocial factors, think about it when you encounter a patient with chronic low back pain. Like we have red flags, we have yellow flag symptoms. Again, that was devised by the Australians. It's the psychosocial risk factors. Again, I'm not going to go through it for the sake of time. Again, we need to teach our patients that they believe that back pain is harmful or potentially disabling. This is not true. Fear, they avoid behavior and reduce activity levels. Again, we need to indicate them that there is nothing that could make their bad worse. And tendency to low mood and withdrawal from social interaction. This again makes it difficult to think of, you know, to manage and think about depression. They think the tablets could cure them. We need to modify that behavior by saying you need to do it actively rather than just taking the tablet to make you better. Any exercise, the Paris Task Force. Flexion, extension, yoga, anything. When you advise, don't say you can't do anything. You should say no problem. You can go and do whatever you want, provided that you rule out that there is no instability. This is very important. Key to success is activity, any form rather than specific time. Back belts. This is another important point. The National Institute for Occupational Safety and Health has concluded that there is no there is insufficient data to support back built endorsement. The patient, they come to my clinic and they say, what about back built, doctor? Should we use it? The answer, clearly, no. There is no evidence to say that back belts can help back pain. On the contrary, they could sort of cause weakness of the muscles and aggravate the symptoms. As we promised, we are not speaking about surgical treatment for back pain, but think about what modalities you have for treatments. You have our colleagues in the physiotherapy department, you have the massage, the chiropractor, the osteopathy, acupuncture, behavior psychology, obviously medications. People in the management team will speak about epidural injections, passive joint injections, and the last thing is surgical intervention. So the list is quite wide. Don't limit yourself just only for medications. Think about referring to the physiotherapist directly. Think about, they always ask about massages and manipulations. Always say yes, it does help. If you have the luxury for psychopathic, psychology assessment, again, there is no harm. Surgical, yes, we are surgeons, we love doing surgery, but again, we need to do the right thing for our patients. If they have to, they have to. Whether it is simple instrumentation, whether it's what we call 360, you open it anteriorly and posteriorly, whether you need to replace the disc instead of fusion. The modalities are wide, and the debate is not concluded regarding which approach is best for back pain. Once I attended the American Academy, and that was something that I always end my lecture with. A few questions, all right? How should you protect your back? All right. Something that we can keep is in our clinic, give it to the patient. Simple questions, and we might do it in Zahra and maybe translate it in Arabic. About back belts, pulling or pushing. This is something that, if you are interested, we can send it to your clinics and translate it to Arabic. I'm thankful for your attention. Any questions before we move on to our next speaker? Sir.
Thank you for the nice talk.
Pleasure.
I'm not from the visiting man, I recommend. I saw a patient last week in my clinic.
Yes.
With interscapular pain.
Yes.
Of marked severity.
Yes.
See? You know what was the cause? It was acute myocardial infarction.
Yes.
The patient was admitted to the ICU. Last year, two tests were done for the complete resolution of the back pain. So one must be very alert in saying it is an orthopedic problem.
Definitely, sure. That's why when we spoke about back pain, we spoke about abdominal problems.
Yeah.
I'm sure we're going to mention it for cervical pain. Interscapular, think about the heart.
Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Jamal. Much appreciated. We are according to schedule. Everything is okay. I know people are looking at the clocks for the Salah. Promise we won't miss it.